Did you know that in 1998, Gary Trent Sr. got traded from the Blazers to the Raptors 41 games into the season, and now his son Jr. also got traded from Portland to Toronto again exactly 41 games into the season. That's absolutely mind-blowing. The trade deadline has ended, so let's go through all the crazy trades that happened. What up everybody, my name is Stefan and this is Heat Check. Let's get into it. First up, the Chicago Bulls were able to land Nikola Vucevic with his 24.5 points and almost 12 rebounds per game this season. The all-star from Montenegro is one of the most underrated players in the league, and to be honest, I expected and wanted him to go to a better team just to make things a bit more interesting come playoff time. Sure, Zach Lavine got some help, and the team also got Daniel Theis from Boston, so the center position is filled in nicely. But if we take a look at the standings, the most that this trade can do for the Bulls is to actually get them to the postseason. But in the first round, there's definitely not gonna be any problem for any of the top 3 teams. Personally, I wanted the Celtics to make a move for Vooch since they have been in a free fall lately, and they're getting no production at all from the center position, so his 24.5 points would have been awesome for the Celtics, and overall having a guy to throw the ball inside and let him go to work could have helped them a lot. Instead, what they did was make a move for Evan Fournier. On paper, they got a 20 point per game scorer, but that was in Orlando. In Boston, he'll most likely be coming off the bench and boosting the production of the second unit, which has been 5th worst in the league, and for a team that considers themselves as a contender, that's unacceptable. So while they probably won't see those full 20 PPG from him, this is a great addition to the second unit, especially when you consider the fact that all the Celtics needed to give Orlando was Jeff Teague. Fournier is a knockdown shooter who could also come in clutch for the team when they need a score at the end of the game. And rounding things off for this team is the acquisition of Mo Wagner, who honestly I don't see him as a big upgrade over Daniel Theis, so this is sort of like a status quo to me. The team got a bit better overall, but nowhere near the upgrade that they needed to help the guys that are struggling right now. So unless they figure it out and pick it up themselves, this is going to be a tough season for Celtics fans. Philadelphia also got a nice bump in their quest for the championship with George Hill. They as well got him for cheap by giving away Tony Bradley and 2 second round picks in the future. What they get in return though, in Hill, is a stable point guard who can also play off the ball, making him a nice backcourt partner to Ben Simmons. George is also a solid player on the defensive end, so the Sixers have a terrific lineup with him, Joel, Ben, and Matisse Thybulle. Not a game-changing trade, but a nice addition for sure. Which leads us to the team that I believe did make some game-changing moves, and that is the Miami Heat. The godfather Pat Riley was able to pull off another phenomenal move at the trade deadline by staying patient all the way till the end, knowing that the Rockets will need to ultimately trade Victor Oladipo since he's a restricted free agent at the end of the season and will ask for a lot of money. So Miami gets a dynamic 21 point per game scorer who can both penetrate inside and hit the outside shot. This is a great offensive boost and another guy who can play with the ball and create his own shot, similar to how Jimmy Butler does it. The 5 assists per game that go along Oladipo scoring certainly fit in perfectly with the unselfish style of play of the Heat. Another guy who joins the team is Nemanja Bjelica. Depending on how much playing time he gets, the Serbian could prove to be a valuable stretch 4 and a better version of the guy that they sent away, Kelly Olynyk. On top of that, even if this turns out to be a few month rental, and even if Miami doesn't give Victor the big contract that he wants next season, they got this 2-man package for Avery Bradley, who hasn't played in a long time due to injury, and Mo Harkless, who just couldn't fit in with the team, so he fell out of the rotation very quickly. So this is a big win for them in their push for another finals appearance. Now, thing is, this trade by itself isn't groundbreaking. However, I'm looking at the bigger picture. Several high-profile NBA insiders have reported that the Heat are very close to landing the recently bought out LaMarcus Aldridge. I maybe shouldn't rush and make conclusions prematurely, but this is talked about so much, plus Woj reported on it, so I feel like it's basically a done deal. If this turns out to be true, then, in my opinion, Miami is very much back into finals contention, and this stacked lineup top to bottom will be able to hold their own against the top teams like the Bucks, Sixers, and the Nets, of course. And before going to the West, I briefly want to touch on Milwaukee, who now all of a sudden, to me, feel like the worst team out of these four. Despite the addition of Drew and PJ Tucker just recently, I don't know, they don't seem to have the firepower to go against any of the main contenders. Whatever the case may be, the playoffs in the East will be extremely fun to watch, unlike any year I can remember. So, I'm looking forward to it. And we can now go to the West, where I want to start with a sneaky move that sort of went under the radar in my opinion. The Dallas Mavericks, who have struggled with shooting this season and saw how much Seth Curry actually meant to them, have now acquired JJ Redick along with Nicolo Melli from the Pelicans. James Johnson is the main piece going the other way to New Orleans, and he wasn't going to be a big part of this Dallas team and their philosophy, so this is a win for the Mavs. I'm eager to see how this changes the spacing on the floor and if it gives Luka and Porzingis more room to operate now that they have a legitimate knockdown shooter and a guy who the defense must keep an eye on and even chase him around screens all over the floor. I broke down the pick and roll that Zion and JJ played in New Orleans, so it's interesting to see whether he'll be put in some actions with Luka. Next, I like what the Los Angeles Clippers did. They traded away Lou Williams to Atlanta for Rajon Rondo. And hear me out on this one. Lou is a well-beloved character in the league and a guy who can get hot and score a lot of points, but the fact of the matter is that come playoff time, he is close to unplayable since the opponents are always hunting him on defense, so any points that he's able to score are nullified by the amount that the Clippers give up on defense by having Lou Will on the floor. So now they get a legit and stable presence on that end of the court, but perhaps even more important, a playmaker. They were trying to make things work by having a hybrid of Patrick Beverley, Reggie Jackson and Lou Will run the point guard position, but it was obvious that things are not gonna work long term like this. Rajon Rondo is a great guy for the job, and one that can find superstars like PG and Kawhi in the right place at the right time. The Denver Nuggets made a big splash by getting Aaron Gordon, a versatile and athletic wing. Honestly, this is filling a hole that they made by letting Jeremy Grant go to the Pistons and losing out on his production. 14.5 points and 6.5 rebounds that Gordon brings with him to Colorado will be a nice help for Jokic and Murray, who by themselves definitely don't have enough to go against the top dogs in the Western Conference. Is this changing a whole lot though? In my opinion, not really. But we'll see how Aaron, as well as JaVale McGee, who the Nuggets also got at the deadline, will be able to help this team in the playoffs. And to end things how we started, I want to elaborate on the Gary Trent Jr. trade, more specifically the guy that the Blazers received in return, Norman Powell. At first sight, the team should have focused more on strengthening their defense since Portland is ranked second to last in defense while having the 7th best offense in the league. So I'm not sure I understand the decision to flip a 15 point per game scorer in Gary Trent for a 20 per game in Powell. Norm does shoot the 3 better however, and I guess any extra help that Dame and CJ could get is welcomed, but again, I would have loved to see a boost to their defense as they prepare to go against the best of the best in the Western Conference playoffs. Let me know in the comments what trade did you like the most and which team got better. That's it for now, subscribe and talk to you in the next one. Peace out. Wow, talk about an unlucky bounce. Way to end the streak, baby. Come on.